Right, so let's start. Next speaker is Pilar de Teodoro. She works at the ESAC Science Data Centre of the European Space Agency, and she is talking to two things very dear to my heart. The Euclid mission, the scientific archive system. I've been working for Euclid for a pretty long time, about 8 years, and data interoperability.
I'll go ahead. Okay. So my name is Pilar de Teodoro, and this presentation is on behalf of the Euclid Scientific Archive System, which is part of the ESAC Science Data Center. I will review today the data interoperability at the core of the Euclid SAS, which is the acronym for the Euclid Scientific Archive System. So let's first put some context for the Euclid mission before talking about data interoperability. And for those of you who are wondering what is the Euclid mission and its goals, let's review some of them. So Euclid is a medium-class mission that will create a 3D map of up to 2 billion galaxies. The Euclid mission wants to understand why the expansion of the universe is accelerating and what is the nature of the source responsible for this acceleration. And this is what the physicist refers to as dark energy. So Euclid will explore how the universe evolved over the past 10 billion years. So you can imagine the enormous tsunami of data produced that will be about 26 petabytes per year of observations. And here below, you can see in this nice diagram, the Euclid survey plan. And each color represents 1 year of observations. And it's not flying yet. And it's expected to be launched in the second half of 2022, most probably in September. And we'll fly during 6 years with a post-operation phase of 2 years. It will be in the second Sun-Earth Lagrangian point, where currently that there are other satellites such as Gaia. So it will count with a 1.2 meter aperture telescope and will have two instruments, a visible light camera, the VIS, and a near infrared camera and spectrometer, the NISP. So the European Space Agency is the responsible for the mission, and ESA selected the Euclid Consortium as the single team having the scientific responsibility of the mission, the data production, and of the scientific instruments. It's a wide consortium. They are involved 15 countries and almost 1,500 members by now. So as we are talking about data interoperability, let's review then the data workflow for Euclid. Okay, so we go from the satellite data to the level 3 data to be published to the public. Here you can see that from the satellite, the data goes to the antennas, and from the antennas to the Mission Operations Center in Germany, and then to the Science Operations Center in ESAC in Madrid here. The level one data is distributed then to the science data centers around Europe and the US, and those centers will process the data to get level two and level three. And also we will get external data for completeness from ground segment telescopes. All of this information will return to ESAC, to the Science Operations Center, and it will be transferred to the Scientific Archive, which will make data available first to scientists in the consortium and then to the general public. All the data in orange goes to the archive. That is where I work. And what is the Euclid Archive System? So the EAS is a joint development between ESA and the Euclid Consortium, and is led by the Science Data Center of the Netherlands and the ESAC Science Data Center. The Euclid Archive System is composed of three main subsystems: the data processing system, which will process the data, the DSS platform to distribute the data between the different data centers, and we finally arrive to the Scientific Archive System. The Scientific Archive System will be fed by the DPS, and will allow the data to be explored by the scientific community using advanced services. Sorry. The estimated size of the Scientific Archive System is about 10 petabytes of images, catalogues, and spectra after the six years of mission. But in these pictures, we describe the interoperability of the different components. Important to notice here that the data model from the SAS is different from the one in the DPS. So we will have a science exploitation data model and a Euclid common data model. And also, just to remark here that the Euclid uses a metadata-centric approach. So everything is recorded into a database. And for security reasons, there will be always a replica of the DPS metadata in the other location of the Euclid archive. Currently, the master is in the SDC of the Netherlands, and we have the standby. And hopefully, by the end of this year, we will be masters, and Groningen will have the standby. So, the Euclid Archives, Science Archive System. So, we have already, we are working on this, on the archive already. And what we want is to see how the Science Archive System manages the data releases with the help of the BIO protocols. And for that, you must know that there exists already this archive. And we are working with simulated data, of course. And if you're wondering what is the link, sorry, members only so far, but it will be public in the future. So you know that nowadays, the astronomy science is inherently interoperable from science data and models perspective, but also from the tools and interfaces to exploit them. And in that respect, the International Virtual Observatory Alliance is the organization whose main missions pushes for the data interoperability in astronomy, and the Euclid Archive has been part of it from an early stage. So to get the data into the scientific archive, the data will be ingested into a petascale data storage and the metadata kept into a massive parallel processing database. In our case, this is a Green Plan open source cluster. And so from here, then, and with the help of the IBOL standards such as TAP+, DataLink, SIAP, SSA, SODA, Biospace, HIPS, ADQL, the data will be exposed through a web portal or also using the science exploitation platform from ESA that Vicente Navarro has explained this morning, the ESA Data Labs, that's taking the paradigm of bringing the code to the data. And for example, then using Astropine Jupyter Notebooks, the data will be available. So let's review then some of these standards. So starting with ADQL, because without it, we will not be able to retrieve any information from the database in the UI or from a Jupyter notebook. It's the way we have to write astronomical queries to the database. So we make it then more easy to understand for scientists who don't have to know how they are written in the database itself. So ADQL is based in SQL 92. So I'm pretty sure that astronomers that know ADQL know SQL, but they don't have to know how to use Postgres extension such as PSphere or Q3C. So,
Pilar, 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. So every time a query is submitted, a job is created, and then you can see here all these icons that will be related to different actions and other BIO protocols. Okay, so let's then see when a query is submitted, then how it goes to the database. So we use the Table Access Protocol, the TAP, to get this information. So TAP defines a service protocol for accessing general table data. And in Euclid, we use the ESDC extension, which is called TAP+. TAP+, add more capabilities like authenticated access and persistent user storage area. And as you know, the TAP provides two operations modes, synchronous and asynchronous. So we use also the Universal Worker Service, the UWS, to help with the creation of jobs per each query. So use especially with asynchronous queries. And with the information icon that we have in the other slide, when we click on it, we can get the information of the job panel with the job information that the UWS give us for all the job details. And 2 slides before, I was commenting on the query run using ADQL, and I don't know if you were able to see what kind of query was that, because when we get to this ADQL form, we can write here the queries that we want, and in this case, what we have is a concert. So this is an example of a concert written in ADQL through TAP. So what we are trying, maybe here you can see it much better, right? We are trying to retrieve all sources from a catalog, in this case is the flagship mock, and in an area within 0.1 degrees with some given coordinates. Then we can add as well other filters. So as a BIO protocol, we will offer the concert interface directly in the future. Currently it's ADQL through TAP. And for the OBSCore, we created an OBSCore view abstraction over the Euclid Science Data Model. It homogenizes the access to the images in Euclid and the derived data, such as the mosaics. For example, here in the calibration level, will tell us what type of images we are working with. This make it very powerful to be used by any other archive, or also to be used by other protocols, as we will see later. Okay, thank you. HIPS uses the Hilpix tessellation of the sky. And from Fitch data files, what we are doing is using the HIPS gen to get a HIPS file generated. And this is part of the ingestion pipeline. The result in the archive shows an image which is zoomable. Footprints, for example, here in footprints of observations can be seen in pink. And in green, we can see mosaic footprints that can be overlaid over the image. So another view protocol uses in the SAS is the simple image access protocol, providing capabilities for the discovery, description access, and retrieval of multidimensional image data sets. So how do we use it? Well, this uses the OBSCore data model. And the way that it works is that we have some input parameters corresponding to the view protocol. Let's see much better here. So which are the positions that defines the positional regions to be searched, like the circle, range, and polygon. And what we will get, it will be a list of cutouts. And this is the sample of what we get with the SciApp help. In the future, we will use the server-side operation for data access, the SODA protocol, to run cutouts asynchronously. This will allow us to get synchronous and asynchronous cutouts. And sorry, I forgot to mention the SSAP that will be done for the spectra. And here with data link, we currently use it for giving access to derived data from the sources or observations in a catalog. The ID used can be the source ID, observation ID, or the tile index. In this case, it's the object ID corresponding to the source ID. And it's expected that in QR1, estimated in 2024, it's very probable that we can publish spectra through data link. So VioSpace as well, we use it for is the IBO interface to distributed storage. And we use it so we can send the information from a job directly to the VioSpace area. So it can be shared with others or to be used in the future. And this is the look and feel of the VioSpace. So this is our VioSpace area currently. And so we can share it with, make it a public link to share with different users, to upload, download the files or folders, etc. And so finally, and just with the conclusions, so the interoperability through virtual observatory standard has been part of the core of the scientific archive system design from the very beginning. And the usage of view protocols in previous archives confirms their importance for achieving the scientific goals of the community of astronomers. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any question, I will be happy to try to answer them.
Thank you, Pilar. Somebody write something on the question box? Not apparently. I have a question which has to do with the nice talk, thanks, Pilar. You mentioned PG Sphere, but also Greenplum. What are you using for spatial queries on Greenplum?
So currently for spatial queries, Greenplum is a Postgres distributed. So we can use Q3C and PG Sphere. So you can just compile the extensions directly in Greenplum, Hilpix as well. So there is no problem with this. The only thing is that we have to optimize, for example, for the cross matches, that the Q3C indexing is not, it's not performant really well with Greenplum, because we have to find this way of also partitioning the data on the different nodes, on the different segments in Greenplum. And this is this is something we are working on. We have also, I have to mention, we have also made some tests with Spark and AXS, but when comparing the results, Spark was much faster, but the results were not the same with Q3C and AXS. And then we found out that in the AXS, there were some problems regarding the polls, the algorithm for the polls in the cross-matching. So we are working with them, but so far, GreenPlan is a very good mature technology now for scaling out Postgres.
Alberto Mikkel is asking that you mentioned 26 petabytes per year of data. How many records per year in GreenPlan?
Well, actually, the 26 petabytes will be of all with the intermediate products. In the SaaS, it will be 10 petabytes. But in GreenPlan, what we will have will be the catalogs. It's the metadata for the scientific archive system and the catalogs. So you can imagine that it's very probable that next year we will just have a 10 terabytes catalog. And this is like 10 times more than the Gaia catalog. So we expect to have a really a bigger amount of catalogs, and that has to be in a MPP database.
Thank you, Pilar, again.